the greatest joy, sometimes we forget about it, and when we need to learn to express that in worship before the Lord. This afternoon, I want to share with you from Acts chapter 27, verses 9 to 32. I will read to you later. We are looking at another passage from Paul's journey. Paul made three missionaries' journey, and in each of the journey, there are shorter journeys. This is one of his journey. He is, as I read that passage, I want you to know the background, that he has just appeared before King Agrippa to present his case of his innocence of spreading the gospel. And then King Agrippa couldn't find actually really anything wrong with him and all that, and could have sentenced him, but the whole thing resulted in that, rather than sentence him, send him to Rome. Because Paul actually, they wouldn't have sent him to Rome, but Paul actually make a petition. He says, I want to appear before the Roman Empire to present my case. So he was being, as we read, he's going to be escorted now by sheep to meet the Roman Roman Emperor. And this ship that he was traveling in met with a huge storm and was eventually wrecked. Was shipwrecked, was completely gone. Acts chapter 27, 10, verse 10 onwards, record this for us. If you would just follow me in your Bible as we read this together. I know it's a little bit long passage, but it is so straightforward. And as you follow, you'll understand when I just share with you three things. Three things I'd like you to consider. One, the causes for this shipwreck, the consequences, and eventually the conclusion. Verse 10 of chapter 27 reads, Paul saying, men, I can see that our voyage is going to be disastrous and bring great loss to ship and cargo and to our own lives also. But the centurion, instead of listening to what Paul said, followed the advice of the pilot and of the owner of the ship. Since the harbor was unsuitable to winter in, the majority decided that we should sail on, hoping to reach Phoenix and winter there. This was a harbor in Crete, facing both southwest and northwest. Let me explain a little bit thing here. It says, since the harbor was unsuitable to winter in. Doesn't bring across the original meaning very clearly. It's not that it is unsuitable. Actually, when you do a research, you find that they were reluctant. They were reluctant to do it because it's a small city compared to Phoenix. Phoenix is just about 40 miles away. So, being a small town, convenience are not there. And if they were to winter there, that means if they would stop there and overnight or wait, what's going to happen is that finding lodging is going to be a problem. So everything is not convenient at all. So they decided to move on. Verse 13, when a gentle south wind began to blow, they thought they had attained what they wanted. So they weighed anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. Before very long, a wind of hurricane force called the Northeaster swept down from the island. The ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind. So we gave way to it and were driven along. As we passed to the lee of the small island called Cordia, we were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure. When the men had hoisted it aboard, they passed ropes under the ship itself to hold it together, fearing that they would run aground on the sandbars of Syrtis. They lowered the sea anchor and let the ship be driven along. We took such a violent battering from the storm. That the next day, they began to throw the cargo overboard. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and the storm continued raging, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. They have lost their way completely. With no sun, no star, they could not navigate. That was necessary. So they just gave up. First, they were already driven to, they do not know where. They couldn't catch the wind, meaning that they could not, they have lost control, everything and all that. So they just let it drag along. So they gave up all hope of being saved. Verse 21. After the man had gone a long time without food, Paul stood before them and said, "Men, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have spared yourself this damage and loss. But now I urge you to keep your courage, because not one of you will be lost. Only the ship will be destroyed." Last night, and this is how Paul knows, he says the ship will be destroyed, but none of you will be lost, because last night an angel of the God whose I am and whom I serve stood beside me and said, "Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar, and God has generously given you the lives of all who sail with you." God has a bigger agenda. The people were kept alive because God's agenda was Paul must end up in Rome. You know, last week I shared with you about unprepared interruption. When our lives is interrupted abruptly, when things start going wrong or things just don't seem right, it doesn't mean everything is wrong. When unexpected, as I said, circumstances fall into our lives, like Paul went into jail and everything, it doesn't mean everything is lost. We must learn to remember there's a sovereign God who has a greater agenda. And so it is here. Paul is to go to Rome, and there actually he will be preaching to everybody there. So he says, "You must stand trial before Caesar, and God has graciously given you the lives of all these men." Verse 25, "So keep your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. Be it unto me according to your word." Nevertheless, we must run aground on some island. On the 14th night, we were still being driven across the Adriatic Sea. When about midnight, the sailors sensed that they were approaching land. They took soundings and found that the water was 120 feet deep. A short time later, they took soundings again and found it was 90 feet deep. Fearing that we would be dashed against the rocks, they dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Just pretending. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, "Unless this man stay with the ship, you cannot be saved." So the soldiers cut the ropes that held the lifeboat and let it fall away. We'll stop our reading there. The ship Paul was on got into trouble, real serious trouble, you know, a hurricane, a storm and everything. And eventually it was shipwrecked. All those that happened that they got into trouble could have been avoided. There were several reasons why it ended up that way. And we're going to look at first the causes of it. It looks at first when you read that there is a strong wind, and that is the one, the northeaster, that caused it. The fact that it's given a name, northeaster, clearly shows the weather was not the real cause. Storms at that period of time was very common. It's only a matter of how accurate it can be. But it is a common thing that there will be this hurricane and it will come at this time of the year. So every seafaring person, every sailors, people who move into the sea will avoid sailing at this time. The boat, the ship that Paul was in should have avoided it because it is known that this will happen. But because they were behind schedule, if you read the earlier, because we have lost much time in the earlier part of the journey, they decided that they want to push on. Let me give you five reasons as you look at the verses here, why, what are the causes of the problem. The first one is they were in a hurry. They were in a hurry and decided not to wait. Or in my word, they were impatient. They were just impatient to get their job done. They wanted to get to the port, unload the prisoners, unload the cargoes and everything, and let it be done with. They were in a hurry. That's the first cause. The second cause, they were warned already by a godly man. By that time, although Paul was a prisoner, escorted to Rome, he's already established a name that this is a man of God. And God is with him. Although they may not be willing to free him and everything, but he warned them that this will be disastrous for you. Everything, it will cause great loss and everything. Did they hear? No. They decided against him. They dismissed his warning. Although warned. The third reason is they decided to take the majority decision. The centurion preferred to hear what the ship owner and the pilot has to say. They are the experts. They are the skillful one. They know better than Paul. And it is true. And therefore, they decided that since the majority, the word appears there, decided to move on, they decided they will move on. Could they have avoided the storm? Answer, yes. Of course they can. But because of their hurriedness, because of their desire to get the thing over with, and sometimes we do that, and because of the majority, let's go, let's go, let's go, let's go, and that's the right decision, or that's the best decision, they went ahead. And the fourth reason I've given to you already, they desired convenience. Where they were, which is called Fair Havens at the time, is a small town, not good to winter in. It entails inconvenience of finding lodging for every single person. Disembark and find lodging and stay there. And in a small town, you know that is not easy. Food and everything will be inconvenience. So they didn't want that. They prefer the larger and more popular Phoenix. After all, it's 40 miles away only. 40 miles. Let's go down there and things will work out so much better. You know, when I read that part, you know what I was thinking? We sometimes want to go on a retreat to a 5-star hotel. When we talk about 3-star, we talk about camping, forget about it and everything. And it's almost that thought came to my mind. Do we just desire convenience or do we desire something else? A meeting with God. So those were four reasons, and the fifth reason was the decision was based upon circumstances. They looked and they saw a gentle wind that was blowing, and therefore they thought, we often think, they had obtained the right decision. So with all of this, they moved on. They moved on. Nothing seems to be wrong as they move on. That is why they went. And it's only after that later we see that. Now let's bring this to today's experiences in our lives. And we must ask ourselves the questions. Do we dismiss godly advice? Do we dismiss godly warnings too easily? Do we say, too much lah? I know that a lot of Christians would dismiss that not to mention the non-Christian. But Christian also say, ayah, too strict lah, too much lah, everything and all that. It won't happen. Do we seek convenience? We avoid inconvenience for the easiest way. So the moment something comes on you, you know, they will take the easier way. This is why, as a pastor, I don't believe in giving option. Too much option. Because when you give people option, they will always take the easier way. I just recently told a few of our church members, I said, our church retreat is in June. Do you want to come? Yes, is the answer. But immediately it is followed by, but I got this new job, or I will be into a new job, or I will be switching jobs, and therefore I cannot come. My challenge to them, and I spoke to them, not harshly, but lovingly, just said, would you consider praying about that? Would you consider praying about that? The easier way is just say, I cannot come. The inconvenient way, the tougher way, is to speak to your employer, prospective employer. You know, I made this commitment 2 months or 3 months ago. And I like to keep that commitment. Can you give me leave on that time? Why not? If our God is a great supernatural God, why not? And in ex-Baptist Church, it has happened more than once before. That the answer is yes. Go ahead. Are we too presumptuous about that? So in our modern life, we act very much like the sailors. We want an easier way out. We dismiss warning, and then sometimes we just, very often, we want to get our duties done with. This is a job, this is a duty. Let's get it done with quickly. I've done my job, and that's it. Do we do that? We must ask ourselves. And do we use words like everybody is doing it, the majority are doing it? So I think it is okay. We keep up with the trend, we keep up dressing with the trend, we keep up behaving like what the world is doing. We say the majority are doing, so it should be okay. We make decisions based upon skills of the person, we make on the what you call the intellectual abilities of the person. We too often, very fast, make decisions based upon circumstances and say, let's move on. That's it already. Open doors, last week I talked about. Open doors. And the wind came, and it's a gentle wind as they start. Looks like open doors. Looks like we thought we had it right, and they move on. When we act this way as a church, when we act this way as individuals, we will head for storms. It is almost unavoidable. We could have avoided it, but we will end up in a storm. Let's look at the consequences next. What happened? They stubbornly went ahead, and as we read earlier on, they lost everything. The ship went aground, planks were falling apart and everything. Every person has to jump out, hang on to a plank and go to the shore. And if you read down, everything, their cargo, everything was lost. But sometimes you forget the part that their lives were endangered. If it's not for the grace of God, they will all have perished. And when I say the grace of God, I don't use it as a cliche. We say, oh, by God's grace, we are okay. Oh, by God's grace, sometimes very often we use it. By God's grace, I was all right. By God's grace, and all these things. But here, truly, I want us to see that it is truly the grace of God. A great God, with one with great love, who showed His love, who initiated it, and showed it upon them. And you must understand, grace is love unmerited. Or love that you don't deserve, but you get it. Were these people deserving of that love? No. They were stubborn. They were self-sufficient. They make decisions on their own. They saw circumstances and everything. They were very self-centered and proud. They would not take advice and warning. And if you ask, would God, should God save these people? In our logical mind, in our world, the answer is no. But God showed grace upon them. The consequences were severe. They lost everything. And if it's not for the grace of God, their own lives would have gone. Let's see what they lost. Let's look at a closer thing, what they went through. Because sometimes when I say this, we don't put ourselves in that position. We go away, we just say, that was a message that talking about paying attention only. But let's go along and see what. The first thing that happened, if you take a closer look, what the emotions they went through is that, first thing, they lost sense of direction. It says clearly that they had no direction. They were driven along. Verse 15, the ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind. That means lost control. It's like taking your hands off the steering wheel, going downhill and just let it move in any way. So they gave way to it and were driven along. Is that a nice feeling to get into? Driven with no control. Verse 17, the second part, it says, they lowered the sea anchor in a desperate attempt to hold it, everything, and let the ship be driven along again. In a more modern way, the first part is letting go of the steering wheel downhill, and the steer goes anywhere it wants, and then desperately, you just step on the brake, so that it will be slower, and hopefully it will come to a stop, and that you can gain control, but it was not happening. You know, very often we are driven by the world until we lose control. You're driven by your bosses, you're driven by your work, you're driven by ministries. There is a deadline, there's an urgency and everything. We are so driven until we lose control. Second part, they were emotionally and physically drained. They were washed out. Totally washed out. Completely exhausted. If you look at verse 18, after, you look at them and you see that. The other thing, let me just say, they became very desperate. They were so emotionally drained and washed out, physically exhausted, and they were very desperate. They actually no longer care for what they have. They are willing to throw everything overboard. They're willing to throw everything. Verse 18. We took such a violent battering. They were so battered up from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. Too much. It is too much already. It looks like we will never get control anymore. This is too exhausting trying to keep the ship alive. This is too exhausting for life. I'm giving up. They threw everything. It doesn't matter if I lose my job. It doesn't matter everything. And the fourth thing is that they were in great despair and they lost all hope. Verse 20. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and the storm continued raging, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. Ever reached that stage? Because of the decisions we made, because of the way we act, ever come to this stage and say, I give up hope. Ever think about the connection there at all? In verse 20, it says, when we finally give up hope, and he said we took such a violent battering. You know what I was thinking? It's like an injured man, not dead yet, a seriously injured man pinned under a pile of boulders. Maybe an earthquake shook the building and the building collapsed. And the whole thing is on him right now, and he's underneath the debris, underneath the everything, so huge and everything, and he's suffering excruciating pain because bones are broken, bleeding. Breathing has become so very hard, and at that stage there, he cries out. He said, I'll do anything to get out of this. Even let me die quickly. That's what hopelessness it means. You see, sometimes we forget about excruciating pain. Another thing, some of the soldiers, some of the sailors, they became very wicked and scheming. In their mind, it's no longer, these are my family, you know. These are my shipmates, you know. These are my friends, you know. These are people who have gone through with me, who have walked with me and everything. These are people who have helped me before. Suddenly, at that stage of facing the storm, they said, I don't care what happened to them. It's each man for his own. And they're willing to leave their shipmate behind. That's why in verse 30 you read, in an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Pretending they were going to help them, but actually they're going to run. As long as I get off the ship, as long as I sail away safely, if the rest die, it does not matter. Scheming and wickedness. We sometimes read this as a story, but if we bring it to a modern day, consequences of this, of the way that we are affected by it, it's not far. It's not far. We have seen people who have ignored godly advice, insist on continuing their own path, believing that the consequences may not happen. They have been warned, but no lah. Or when it happened, I can take care. They think it may not happen. And this is one passage says that consequences will always follow our action. Although they were spared by the grace of God, the ship was totally lost, the cargo was all lost. Those were great consequences. The emotions that they went through were great consequences. But we have people today who believed that they will not be affected and they just push on with what they want to do. My point of sharing this with you is that this is a big, big deception. It's the greatest lie we can lie to ourselves, that we can bear with consequences or consequences may not come. It's a lie of Satan. Because our attitude will change. Our attitudes will change. And we will not be able to bear it. We will not be able to bear it. Not at all. And don't say, I will be able to take it because God is with me. No, except for the mercy of God only. It does not entail you to say, God be with me. But it's by the mercy of God. You read about them dropping all their cargoes and everything. And the cargo, obviously, they are not going to carry junks and everything. Obviously, include valuables. You know what I think about when you throw your valuables, when you're in a storm because of wrong decision already, and you still stubbornly want to go ahead and you still want to survive, you start throwing things overboard. You know what I'm thinking about? We throw away our Christian values. The valuable thing in our life, we sometimes will throw away when we're in a storm. The words of God, the promises of God, we will all throw away just to keep on going our own way. And when it comes to scheming and being wicked, we lie to get ahead. These are some of the consequences that follows the action that we have taken earlier on that were wrong. Drivenness. We are driven by the world methods and we lose all sense of direction. We no longer know right from wrong. It's a common thing. It's a very, very common thing. The ship got into trouble. Five causes of death. Maybe not all five for us in our modern days, but maybe one or two of it could drive us into a storm. And when in the storm, we go through all the emotions and everything. Let us now see how it ends, the conclusion of it all. They have gone through desperation, they despair, they give up, they lost, even actually you read, for 14 days they have not been eating, they lost all appetite. They don't even bother to eat to survive anymore. And of course, the only thing on their mind is, The conclusion is that they wanted to abandon ship. We were told that the ship went aground. And then they were each told in the end to jump overboard, take whatever it is, and go to the island when the ship grounded. But that was under instruction already. Here, without instructions, they're already thinking about abandoning ship. Verse 21, after the man had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up and said, "Man, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have spared yourself this damage and loss." It's like, I told you so. We don't like that. We don't like it. I told you so, this will happen. Of course, being good counselors, being good pastors, we try to put it in a nicer way, but truly, sometimes we deserve words like this. I told you so, right? I told you so, if you drive so fast, one day sure got accident run, right? I told you so, if you ignore the advice, you'll get into trouble, right? Or your days will come, right? But they... Paul had no choice but to really say that in a way. You lost this, you lost that. You could have spared it. Just kind of a reminder to them. And then came the encouraging word. He's not condemning them, but came the encouragement. But now I urge you to keep up your courage. Because not one of you will be lost, only the ship will be destroyed. Consequences will always follow our action. Every action has its consequences, either now or in later years. Spoil your child now, pay for it later. Feel the pain later. Discipline your child now, enjoy their life later. That's always the case. So Paul encouraged them. That's an interesting conclusion, actually. You think everything is gone, they abandoned ship, they have given up everything, but Paul said, I urge you, take courage, because not one of you will be lost. And then he said something very important in verse 31. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless this man stays with the ship, you cannot be saved. Conditional. Stay with the ship, no matter what happens. Stay with the ship. Don't abandon ship. Don't jump ship. Stay with the ship. Verse 32. So the soldiers cut the ropes that held the lifeboat and let it fall away. Paul actually, the conclusion is that Paul actually shared a vision that he had from God for these people. He encouraged them. He said, take courage. Not because I say so. Don't worry. Things will be okay. Because God said He has spared your lives. Eat. Don't starve. Because God's word is true. His promise is true. It will come according to Him. He's saying God has decided to show grace upon you. And in that privacy, Paul actually learned. He learned something as in his earlier experience. God has a greater agenda. Because God says, you must go and face Caesar, the Roman emperor. That was why they were saved. They couldn't see that. Paul didn't even could see that clearly until God revealed to him. But they will only be spared if they remain and not abandon ship. I don't want you to miss the part that they cut the ropes. They obeyed Paul. You see, it's not about promises and everything. It's about action. It's about holding on to the promises and taking action. According to your word, let it be unto me. I will stand secure. So they took action and they cut off the ropes to the lifeboats. It means you cut off your escape plans. How often when we are in storm, we have our own escape plans of leaving ship, of jumping ship. They cut off all of that, their only way of survival, they cut all of that and trusted God and they stayed on the ship. I've entitled this, Stay With Your Ship. Because that is the key verse there. Unless this man stay with the sheep, you cannot be saved. We need to stay with the sheep. Yes, wrong decision can be made. We can be in deep trouble. We are facing storms. But the word that God leaves for you and for me is to stay with the sheep. I see this passage as I end speaking to us. The sheep is like our church. You would have already gotten that idea. Ex-Baptist church. The sailors, the pilot, Paul, the soldiers are like members of ex-Baptist church. And a sheep will get into trouble when its members, don't say the whole church itself, don't say it's just the leaders, when any of us start ignoring godly advice because it will soon spread. How come that will can, why I cannot, and all that. When we start following and when we start operating by the ways of the world, using the world's standard of intelligence, of methods and everything, wanting convenience, quick fix, get the job done with, based upon our abilities and capabilities. When we always function in this manner, we will be heading for a storm. Then when we face with a storm, it will be a crisis. It will always be crisis. It will be always endangered. Everything can be destroyed. The only way out, let me say it clearly and slowly, the only way out is to listen or heed the word of God and stay together. That's the only way out. Obey and stick together. So the application I see here is this. First, for us, steer clear of storms. Let's steer clear of storms. Let's not risk it. Let's not say it won't happen. Let's not say I can take it. Let's not say let's try first and everything. Steer clear of it. And even if when we end in a storm, maybe not for this reason, but for certain reason, God bring us there. He is sovereign. He is always in charge. There are unexpected circumstances. Stick together. Not one for its own. Not jump ship. Not run away. Stick together. Stay with your ship. And we will see better days. We will see God's agenda being fulfilled more than our own personal agenda. This is one of Paul's journey. A journey that teaches us to reflect upon our actions, how the world is affecting us, what are the things in the world that is pushing us, steering us into storms. And that we need to say stop to that. We need to say no to that so that we don't end up in a storm. And when for certain reasons we end up in a storm, as in the Bible we always have like Achan's sin and all that, when it happened, it's never, never the end if we stick together. There will be brothers and there will be sisters who will stand by you. And especially when there are godly advice to say, come on, let's face this together. Let's go on this journey together. We may lose a lot, but let's stick together so that we don't lose our Christian values. Let us pray. I will keep silent for a few moments for you to really ponder what the Holy Spirit is speaking to you. The situation that you are in today might be a grateful and helpful decision. You are joyful about it all because you have avoided the causes of storm. And you can thank God for that. And you should push on to that. Hang on to that. But the situation you are in may look very negative and adverse. Could it be one of these causes? Could it be the world pushing you, driving you, rather than you steering your course towards God? Could it be you are just looking at circumstances, determining results are more important than being in full control? I pray you will avoid consequences because they cannot be avoided unless you take the right actions. These negative consequences, these emotions that really tear our hearts apart are not nice emotions, are not placed there by God. He never intended for that. It's our own choices. And would you stick with the sheep? Would you stick with your brothers and sister? If I see my brother or my sister making a big mistake, I don't want to throw them overboard. I want them to stick with me and make it right. Father, you speak clearly. You speak very often, Lord, bluntly, as Paul did, that we could have avoided all this loss and all this pain if we have heeded your word. This afternoon, I pray as each hear your word and as each reflect upon their own lives, both as individual and also for us as a church. We want to heed your word. We thank you that you are God of grace, of mercy. But we take nothing for granted. We will act so that your promises for us can come true. We pray this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. Maybe we should sing the song, the invitation song, Be It Unto Me Again, and you just stand up and you continue. At the beginning part, maybe there was a promise that you were holding on to, you are seeking to. Go back to that beginning there, because I allow that time so that the Holy Spirit can speak to you personally at your point, on your journey. We are all not on the same journey usually. We are at various points of the journey. And if we have said that I want this promise, I want to see this coming, I want to see that, I want to tell you that it will come true according to it, and you can stand secure. But you need also to reflect about the causes of it, if there are, to get rid of those causes. That's the action part. And even in this moment here, you can say, Lord, I thank you for your grace for speaking to me. As we sing this, would you just give yourself up to the Holy Spirit to speak to you? Be it unto me.
Treat me.
Set us free, Lord, to soar on wings of eagles, Lord. And we want to experience that. And at wherever stage it is, Lord, you always lift us up from the miry pit, Lord, to stand upon the rock, because you are our rock. I pray, Father, that our faith will stand firm upon you. That we will learn from today everything, Lord, is about your word and what it speaks to us. And thank you for journeying with us. As you have journeyed with Paul, we allow you to journey with us. It is in Jesus' name we pray.